Hello guys, good evening to all of you. Welcome to the session. I give you warm welcome on behalf of meditation. Hello Jack. Hi Sahil. Good morning. Good evening people. A very good evening to all of you. And hello to everyone whosoever is entering into the class. Hello, Praveen. Hi, Sai Kiran. Hi, guys. Good evening. Good evening to all of you. I hope that it's a good evening for all of you. Hi, Sarita. Hi, Vidhi. Okay, so I think that now we should start our session, right? Okay. All right, guys. Okay, fine. So now we are beginning with the session with a sneak peek as we have been doing till now, right? And as usual, two questions will be given right in front of you. So we are beginning with our first question, which says, who is the poet of the poem, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner and Snake? Okay, three options are given. First one is Percy by Shelley and Saki. Second is Samuel Taylor Coleridge in D.H. Lawrence. And the third one is Vikram Seth in D.H. Lawrence. So, out of these three, which one is correct? Who is the poet of the poem, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner and Snake? Okay, Prince is saying one. What about others, guys? Come on. It's an easy question. Who is the poet of the poem? Okay, Samuel Taylor Coleridge and D.H. Lawrence. Okay, Sarita is saying two. Okay, I'm getting the answers. Many of you are saying two. Okay, so let me tell you the correct answer then. Absolutely correct, guys. You guys are going great. Here, the correct answer to your question is your option number two, which is your Samuel Taylor Coleridge and D.H. Lawrence. Guys, from your examination point of view, just do not be in any confusion in the context of the poets of the poem. All right? Because RTCs will be asked, and in that case, you should be very well aware about the correct answer. Okay? Okay. So now we are coming to the next question, which says, are these terms or phrases found in the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner and Snake? Okay. So the first one is, and now the storm blast came. Where will you find this particular phrase? In which of the poems will you find it? Will it be in the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner or in Snake? Will it be in the poem one, that is the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, or the poem two, that is Snake? Where will you find it? Okay, Snake, with you saying one. Okay, rhyme of the Ancient Mariner. Okay, everybody is saying Rime of the Ancient Mariner. Absolutely correct, guys. This you will find in your poem, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. Now let's come to the second one. As green as emerald. What about this? Where will you find this? As green as emerald. Okay, Prince is saying snake for the second one. Okay. Oh, all right, people are saying one as well. Okay, so that means that there is some kind of confusion in it, right? As green as emerald. Okay, I'm getting so many ones now, so that means that people have arrived at the correct answer now. Okay, Rupesh is saying one, Jack is saying one, Tejas is saying snake, Prince is saying one. Okay, so let me tell you the correct answer. The correct answer for this very particular option is again your poem one, which is the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner. Okay, fine. Now let's move to the another one. He vanishes in the ripples. What exactly is the correct answer for this? He vanishes in the ripples. What exactly is the correct answer? Who is he in this particular phrase? And which poem is it about? Snake, okay, fine. Vidhi, Deepak, Ria, Okay, everybody is saying snake. Prince is saying snake. Absolutely correct, guys. Now let's move to the another one. It ate the food, it never. Which one is correct in this one? For the fourth one, what exactly is the poem? Come on, guys. What exactly is the poem for the fourth one? What exactly is the poem? Okay, so there is a kind of a confusion in it, right? Some people are saying snake and some are saying Asian mariner. Okay, let me tell you the correct answer for this. This is again from your poem, which is the rhyme of the Asian mariner. Okay, all right. And the last one, and graceful are his shapes. What are we talking about in this particular phrase? And to which poem does it belong to? Come on, tell me. And graceful are his shapes. Which poem does this phrase belong to, guys? Come on. I think you guys have read it, right? Okay, so let me tell you the correct answer. Here, the correct answer is again your snake. Okay, fine. All right, let's move ahead now. We are starting with the poem, The Rhyme of the Asian Mariner, and it's written by S.T. Coleridge, as answered by you all. Now, let's move ahead. Okay, so we are going to start with the outline of the poem, and I'm going to read it. Just pay attention to whatever I am reading for your better understanding. First one is, three people are going to attend a wedding party. All of a sudden, a mariner comes and stops one of them. The mariner is unnaturally old and wrinkled, and he wants to talk to the wedding guest about a voyage. Okay, but they're not interested and walk ahead. But one of them is mesmerized by the old sailor's glittering eyes. Just pay attention to all the words that are used in the context of the old man. Okay, all right. The wedding feast is ready and he has to be there, but is unable to move. He is spellbound and compelled by the mysterious mariner to sit on a stone and listen. Three people are going to attend a wedding party. All of a sudden, a mariner comes and stops one of them. The mariner is unnaturally old and wrinkled and he wants to talk to the wedding guest about a voyage, but they are not interested and walk ahead. But one of them is mesmerized by their glittering eyes, right? The sailor starts the story of his adventures even as music is heard from the wedding party. The wedding guest, while imagining that the bride must be waiting for her groom, is forced to hear the tale. He listens in fascination as the story progresses. On a journey, the ship was sailing smoothly with no untoward incidents happening on the way. I think, guys, that this is relatable to each one of you, right? All was well until a storm broke out and drove the ship southwards and into an icy patch. The ship was in great danger and it was surrounded by ice on all the sides. The towering ice blocks were overwhelming and impenetrable. All the sailors were desperate as they could feel death moving towards them. Okay, I think that you guys can very well relate it. Out of the mist, they saw an albatross move towards them. The sailors gave food to the bird and treated it kindly. The albatross started flying over the ship in circles and soon the ice broke, making way for the ship to steer clear, right? A clear and good wind sprung up, which enabled the ship to sail out of the dangerous waters. I think that this is relatable to each one of you, right? The central idea of the poem, as we are talking about, is basically the story that is being narrated by the old man, as in the entire idea is revolving what actually happened to the people who were sailing on a ship, right? The albatross followed the ship and the sailors could naturally feed him with food. The ship kept on sailing and the bird moved along with it as if bringing good luck to them. However, the Asian mariner who is narrating the story confesses to the audience that he acted on impulse one day and shot down the albatross. Okay. No sooner did the bird die than the mist that covered the ship cleared and the wind died, making the ship stand still. Okay. All the sailors blamed the mariner for making the wind disappear. At the same time, they praised him for clearing the mist. With the death of the bird, things started becoming difficult for the ship. Okay. I hope that you guys are very well able to relate to this, right? Here we are basically dealing with the outline of the poem. We are not going line by line, rather, we are hitting on the things that are important in the poem, right? Now the sun became blindingly hot and the wind did not move. So these are the after effects, okay? After what as in what exactly happened after killing the bird. Day after day, the ship stood still like a picture of a painted ship on a silent ocean. All right. They remained like that for many days, and it was ironical that in spite of being surrounded by water on all the sides, they did not have water to drink. This was one of the ironical situations in the poem. They were horror struck to see weird creatures crawling on the sea all around them. The sailors were thirsty and due to their parched lips, unable to speak. All of them believed that the spirit of the albatross was following them and causing them so much misery, right? They blamed the mariner for their misfortune and made him pay for it by hanging the dead albatross round his neck, just like a cross. He was hated by the sailors, young and old. I think, guys, that this was relatable to each one of you because this is what exactly is given in your poem. And I would personally suggest to all of you, just do not take your poems lightly because RTCs will definitely be asked in your examination. And in order to attain good marks in that, just go line by line. Just give a reading on your own to the poem. Okay? All right. So we are starting with the section, which is your quick questions, as we have been doing till now. And now we are beginning with the first question. I hope that you guys are ready to answer the questions now. So the first question says, the Asian mariner stopped one of the three wedding guests because. So four options are given. First one is, he wanted to attend the wedding with him. Second, he wanted him to sit with him. Third, he wanted him to listen to his story. Or the fourth one, he wanted to stop him from going to the wedding. Which one is correct here? Which one is correct? Misery basically refers to the problems, the discomforts in the life, all right? Yes, absolutely correct, guys. Absolutely correct. Here, the correct answer to your question is your option number three, which is your, he wanted him to listen to his story, okay? Let's move ahead now to question number two, which says, the wedding guest remarked that he was next of kin, which means that, first, he was a close relation of the bridegroom, second, he was a close relation of the bride. Third, he was next in line to get married. Or the fourth one, he had to stand next to the bridegroom during the wedding. Which one is correct here, guys? Come on. Which one is correct? Is it your option number one, two, three, or four? Okay, so I'm getting answers. Many of you are saying one. Deepak is saying one. Manoj is also saying one. Mohammed is also saying one. Absolutely correct, guys. Very good. Let's move ahead now. Okay, so now we are coming to the question number three, which says, he cannot choose but hear means. First, the mariner was forced to hear the story of the wedding guest. Second, the wedding guest was forced to hear the story of the mariner. Third, the mariner had the choice of not listening to the story of the wedding guest. Or the fourth one, the wedding guest had the choice of not listening to the story of the mariner. Which one is correct out of these four options? For the third question, which one is correct? Is it your option number one, two, three, or four? Which one is correct here? He cannot choose but hear. What does it mean? Okay, so most of you are answering two. Very good. Absolutely correct, guys. Absolutely correct. Okay. The sun came up upon the left, out of the sea came her. This line tells us that the ship, first, was moving in the northern direction. Second, was moving eastwards. Third, was moving in the western direction or was moving towards the south. Which one is correct? Which one is correct here? First, second, third, or fourth? Which one is correct? Come on, guys. Is it your option number second, third, fourth, or first one? Okay, so here the correct answer to your question is your option number four. That is, it was moving towards the south. Absolutely correct, guys. Whosoever answered it. Okay. So now we are moving to the next section, which says a vocabulary tryout. As I have been stressing on the vocabulary, so I hope that you guys are working on the vocabulary section. So the first question is, give the meanings of the following words. First word is mariner. Come on. Right in front of you, six words are given. First is mariner. Second is glittering. Third is loon. Fourth is kirk. Fifth is skin. And the sixth one is bassoon. Okay, so out of these six questions or words, I will like to take only one or two words. So first, I would like to know the meaning for the word bassoon. Come on, guys. Let's hit on this. What exactly is the meaning of this particular word? What do you understand by this? Okay, yes, the correct answer for the first option, that is your mariner, it means sailor. Absolutely correct. Okay, now let's come to the last word, which is bassoon. What does it mean? Come on. This is one of the important words and can be asked in your examination as well. Yes, Prince is saying correctly, it's a musical instrument. Absolutely correct. Very good, guys. Very good. Absolutely correct. Okay, tell me the meaning for the word kirk. What does it mean? Have you ever heard this word before? What exactly is the meaning of this particular word, kirk? What does it mean? I'm on the word fourth, kirk. What does it mean? What do you understand by this term? It basically means church. Okay, I hope that this is relatable to each one of you. Yeah, absolutely correct. The meaning of this word is church. Absolutely correct. Okay, now we are moving to the next question, which is the antonyms of the following words. So, right in front of you, six questions are given. First is choose, second is bright, third is wondrous, fourth is chase, fifth is crack, and sixth is noise. In case of your antonym, be very well aware about the meaning of the word first. Then only you can actually come to the right opposite of that particular word, right? Okay. So out of these words, I will like to take, for example, fifth one, crack. Give me the antonym for the word crack. Please tell me the meaning for the word crack. What do you understand by this? What do you understand by the term crack? Join. Okay, we can basically say, yeah. So the right antonym for this can be your word join, right? What about the word bright? What about the word bright? Yeah, meaning for the word crack was break. That is absolutely correct. But here we are dealing with the antonyms. Tell me the meaning, as in, sorry, the antonym for the word bright. Yeah, absolutely correct, guys. Dull is the right answer here. Okay, now let's move ahead. Okay, it's a grammar assessment, guys. It's very easy. So I think I can get the answers immediately. First one is fill in the blanks. First one is the mariner was forced dash here dash story of dash wedding guest. So out of these four options, tell me the correct one. Is it two, the first one, or second, four, the, or the third one, two, the, or the fourth one, which is two, the, which one is correct here? Which one is correct out of these options? 1, 2, 3, and 4. Absolutely correct, guys. First one is correct. Now, the second question. It was dash messenger, dash god, and it lifted dash fog, dash mist. Which one is correct? First, second, third, or fourth? Come on, read it and tell me that which one is correct out of these four options. Which one is correct? It was the messenger of God and it lifted the fog and mist. Come on, guys, tell me. Okay, so first one here is the correct one, guys. First one is the correct one. Now we are moving to the next poem, which is your snake, and it's written by D.H. Lawrence, as said by you all. So the poem first is We are dealing with the outline of the poem now. This poem is about the poet's encounter with a snake on a hot day. The poet was feeling very hot, so he went to the water trough, wearing his pajamas to quench his thirst. To his utter amazement, he found a snake too had come there to drink water, right? As the poet came down the steps to fill his pitcher with water, he saw a yellow-brown snake moving quickly towards the water trough. The poet saw the snake slithering forward and drinking water slowly. The tap was dripping and the water had formed a small circle near it, and the snake drank to his heart's content, not worried that someone else was there too. The poet had to wait in line like a second comer, although it was his trough. When the snake had finished drinking, he just looked at the poet, flicked his tongue out, and stooped and drank some more. Guys, just be very particular about these details, that what exactly the snake did after he drank water, right? As he watched the snake, the poet remembered what he had been taught in his childhood. His inner voice ordered him to kill the snake because he had learned that the black snakes were harmless, whereas golden snakes were poisonous. He heard whisperings inside him that if he were brave, he should kill the snake with a stick. However, the poet had taken a liking to the snake and confessed that it was difficult to kill him. He liked the snake because the snake had chosen to come to his water trough like a guest to drink water on that very hot afternoon. The snake seemed harmless enough because after drinking, he was departing quietly and peacefully, although without thanking the God for his generosity, right? I hope that you guys are understanding it in a proper manner. The poet was confused about his own feelings. He was not sure whether it was the cowardice to let the snake go or illogical to feel the need to talk to him. He did not understand why he was feeling honored by the visit, yet his inner voice kept on urging him to kill the snake. In spite of all this, the poet did not want to kill the snake, nor did he want him to go away, right? The snake, after quenching his thirst, slowly turned back towards his hole. As the snake started entering his hole, the poet came out of his trance and looked here and there for a stick. He put down his pitcher and picked up a log and threw it at the retreating snake, right? The part of the snake that was still out of the hole twisted and turned, and with much haste, the snake was gone. As soon as the snake had disappeared, the poet realized that he had done a lowly thing, right? He despised himself for his meanness and thought about the albatross that had been shot by the mariner in vain. The snake seemed to the poet like a king in exile who was about to be crowned again. The poet felt sorry that he had missed the chance of meeting the king, but now it was too late. I hope, guys, that this is relatable to each one of you over here, because this is what exactly is given in your poem. Now we are coming to the section of quick questions, and we are beginning with the first question, which says, he seemed to me like a king in exile. The poet refers to the snake as such to emphasize that the snake, first, is like a king enduring banishment. Second, is like a king due to be crowned. Third, is a majestic king who came for a while on earth. Or the fourth one is a majestic creature forced to go into exile by man. Which one is correct out of these four options? Yes, guys, which one is correct out of these four options? That is your option number 1, 2, 3, or 4. What exactly is the meaning of the phrase that was said, he seemed to me like a king in exile? Which one is correct? First, second, third, or fourth? Yes, absolutely correct, guys. Asad is the one who has given the answer properly here. The correct answer is your option number 4. Okay, now we are moving to the next question, which is, a sort of horror, a sort of protest overcame me. The poet is filled with protest because, first, he doesn't want to let the snake remain alive. Second, he fears the snake. Or the third one, he doesn't want the snake to recede into darkness. Or the fourth one, he wants to kill it so that it doesn't return. Which one is correct out of these four options? What exactly is the meaning, as in that what exactly filled the poet with protest? Okay, they are quite mixed answers. Somebody is saying 2, Princess saying 1, Premlata is saying 4, Aryan is saying 3, Kumud is saying 2. Okay, so let me tell you the correct answer, guys. Here, the correct answer to your question is your. Okay, I'm just giving a one more chance. What exactly can be the correct answer here? Okay, Asad is saying three. Okay, so let me tell you the correct answer, guys. Here, the correct answer to your question is your option number three, which is he doesn't want the snake to recede into darkness. Kindly study the poem properly so that you can understand it in a much more clear manner. Okay, now the third question. Cecil and Julie, Edna smoking and burning bowls of the earth are images that convey what? What are these images conveying? First, there are snakes in volcanic areas. Second, the poet lived in a hot area. Or the third one, it was a really hot day when the snake came. Or the fourth one, Sicilian snakes are dangerous. So what exactly is being conveyed over here? Which one is correct here? Okay, somebody is saying three. Saita is saying one. Nandini is saying three. Okay, absolutely correct, guys. Here, the third answer is the correct answer. Okay, now the next one. I thought how paltry, how vulgar, what a mean act. The poet is referring to. What exactly is the poet referring to by using these terms? First one, the snake going into the dreadful hole. Second, the accursed modern education. Third, the act of throwing a log of wood at the snake. Or the fourth one, the act of killing the snake. Which one is correct out of these four? One. Which one is correct? Okay, Abhit is saying C. Or Abhit is saying 2. Purva is saying 3. Absolutely correct, guys. Here, the correct answer to your question is your option number 3. That is the act of throwing a log of wood at the snake. Okay. I hope that you guys are understanding it in a proper manner. Now we are moving ahead. Okay. So now we are again at the vocabulary section. First one is give the meanings of the following words. Right in front of you, 6 words are given, out of which I would like to know the meaning for the first one. Carrot tree. What exactly is the meaning for this? And this can also be asked in your examination in the form of an RTC question. Okay. Come on, guys. Tell me now. What exactly is the meaning of the word carrot tree? What do you understand by this? What exactly is the... It's a fruit tree. Okay. Guys, whenever questions are asked in your examination, be very particular in answering them. As in, just do not be very vague in answering a question. Be very to the point. Okay. Answer should be to the point. Yes, Mohammed is right. It's a red flower tree, which was originally. Where will it found? As in that, where exactly was it found? Tree, it is basically a red flower tree which is originally in the Mediterranean area, right? Okay, now let's come to the another one, which is your mused. What do you understand by this term? Mused. What do you understand by this particular term? Mused. What does it mean? What do you understand by this? What exactly does it mean? Amazed. Mused is basically that you are thinking about something, okay? Thinking about. All right. Now let's. Yes, absolutely correct, Mohammed. That's the right answer. Yes, Prince, that's a correct answer. Yes, even be absorbed in thought. That is also correct. Very good. Okay, now let's come to the antonym. Right in front of you, 6 words are given. First is graceful, second is vanished, third is sudden, fourth is straight, fifth is innocent, and the sixth one is deliberately. Okay. So, tell me the antonym for the word vanish. And for that, you must be very well aware about the meaning as well. So, what can be the antonym for the word vanish? Vanish means to disappear. So, what is the antonym of this word? What is the antonym of this word? Okay, appear, that is right. Absolutely correct. Now tell me the antonym for the another word, which is straight. Straight. What is the antonym of the word straight? We can say curved, right? I hope that you guys can very well relate to it, right? Yes, that is correct. Very good. Ben, that is also right. Absolutely correct. Okay, now let's move to the another section of the this particular session, which is again your grammar assessment. Two questions are given in front of you. First one is, D.H. Lawrence, English novelist, story writer, critic, poet, and painter, is one of the greatest dash in 20th century English literature. Will it be figure, or you can say both one and two can come, or you can say the fourth one, that none of the above mentioned are correct? Which one is correct? Out of these four, which one is correct, guys? Come on. Okay, one of the greatest figure, that means. Okay. Purva is saying one, Prince is saying one. So that means that I'm getting two in majority. Guys, whenever you are having an expression which says one of the, all right, in that case, the word that will be following this particular expression will always be, as in, for example, it's saying one of the greatest, right? So one of the greatest figures. So we are taking one out of many, right? So that is why you will always use a plural word there. I hope that this is clear to each one of you now, because this is one of the important things to be kept in your mind. Okay, so that means that you're talking about one out of so many. So in that case, the word that will be following it, that is the expression one of the, will always be in plural, right? Okay, I hope that you guys have understood it. Now let's go to the next question. The voices dash education dash the poet tell him that it was a fear dash the snake that made him refrain from killing him. First, off inside or for. Second is in into off. Third, into inside off. Or the fourth one, off inside from. Which one is correct out of these four? The voices dash education dash the poet tell him. Okay, I'm getting the answers. Okay, so there is a confusion between four and one. Here, the correct answer to your question is your option number one. Okay, guys? Okay, so we are done with our today's session. I hope that it was helpful to for all of you. Just keep on revising all your chapters in a proper manner so that you can give proper answers in the coming sessions. And just keep on enhancing your knowledge about the words, because this is very important for your writing skills and for your reading comprehension section, right? And you lose a lot of marks in your writing section if your writing skills are not good. That is, your grammatical skills are not good. Okay. So now just pay attention in improving your knowledge about the subject. Till then, have a very good time. We'll be meeting soon on next Monday. All right, guys. Take care. Have a very good time ahead.